You're listening to the audio production of Because of Bethlehem, He Chose the Nails Audio Bible Study by Max Lucado, published by Harper Christian Resources and read by the author. These audio Bible studies are a unique learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, this production includes high-quality live recordings that cover the important points from each chapter, as well as relevant material from other sources. This audio Bible study also has a companion Bible study guide sold separately.
Well, it's that time of year once again, and I have to be honest with you, I love this time of the year. Sleigh bells that ring, the carolers that sing, the trees covered with new fallen snow, the repeats of Charlie Brown Christmas Show. They say that Christmas is a season of traditions. Of course, that doesn't mean I'm fond of every Christmas tradition. In fact, two I'd like to skip are the interruption and the inconvenience. Christmas can require more from us than we have time or energy to handle. The shops are crowded, the grocery stores are packed, and the flights are full. And then there's the midnight phone call from a cousin we barely know, telling us his family is going to be in the area for the holidays. And could they park their Winnebago in the driveway for, oh, we promise, no more than 10 days? Even though I love Christmas, I have to admit, in many ways it seemed more innocent when I was a child, more overflowing with joyful expectation and hope and promise. As a child, I used to count off the days leading up to December 25th, hoping somehow that time would move just a bit quicker as each day got closer to the magic moment. And what, or more appropriately, who has become the living symbol of that great expectation? Well, it's the man in the red suit, the ho-ho-ho guy, the one with the belly full of jelly, the rosy red face, and the beard white as snow, and gifts for every girl and boy. Santa Claus. To most kids, that jolly old elf is the very face of Christmas. And that face is everywhere this time of year. 'Twas the night before Christmas, now starts the day after Halloween, and when Santa's face starts appearing on and in every retail opportunity imaginable, selling everything from slippers to soft drinks, from sofas to shiny toys. Ho-ho-hoing everywhere he goes. There's no escape. He's everywhere. But the smile on the children's faces as they are hoisted up on Santa's lap to share their list of Christmas hopes and dreams, well, that says it all. This is what Christmas is supposed to be. But for you and me, Santa is no longer the face of Christmas. Some time ago, we realized that Santa wasn't real. And Christmas isn't just about presents and brightly decorated sugar cookies. As adults, we face the reality that no matter how much we wish for a different outcome, Christmas can also be a season of sadness, of lost hope and disappointments. Is this a difficult Christmas for you? You watch the holiday special about the loving family at a bountiful table and can't help but compare that to your own reality show that's definitely not so cheery. You look around and prosperity and good health seem to be what everyone else is experiencing, while under your tree and on your plate there seems to be so little of both. You wonder what happened to the simple joy that was Christmas morning, those smiling little faces peeking into the living room, spying the empty milk glass and cookie plate, rushing to open the bright and shiny presents Santa left under the tree. If that's the case for you, if you've lost some of that Christmas joy, and right now you're looking forward to December 26th more than December 25th, then I have a story for you to consider. Imagine a time long ago in a faraway place, a long, perilous road filled with weary pilgrims. And right in the middle of this congested, dust-filled road, a young girl. As much as she tries to keep a good attitude, it's not easy. She is far away from home. miles from family in her own bed. She spent the last few days on crowded roads, and during the winter chill, money is scarce. Friends are nowhere near. A warm bed and a hot meal, the prospects are slim. Her heart aches for her family. Under normal circumstances, they would have been thrilled to learn of her pregnancy, but pregnant before the wedding? With her conservative family and her bizarre explanation, and to have to tell the man she was to marry that she was carrying a child who wasn't his? It was a miracle he still married her. And another miracle is what she needs tonight. She had envisioned giving birth at home, mom holding one hand and an aunt the other, a midwife, doting relatives, Joseph, and a crowd of neighbors just outside the door. Perhaps if they could have all experienced the birth of her firstborn together, then they would believe her story. At least that's how I imagine Mary felt. Of course, I could be wrong. Perhaps the feed trough and stable were her idea, but I don't think so. I've yet to meet a mother-to-be who dreams of using a cow stall for a delivery room and a manger for a bassinet. When Joseph returned from the inn and asked if she was allergic to sheep, it's a safe hunch to say she was chagrined. This wasn't how she had planned to celebrate the birth of Jesus. I pictured Joseph leading the donkey down a steep path that ends at the mouth of a cave. For as long as anyone can remember, it has been used as a barn. He lowers Mary off the back of the donkey and looks at her face, fatigued and powdery from the road. He apologizes for the austere accommodations. She smiles and enters the grotto. Joseph builds a fire and heats the water. Mary clears a spot on the straw and sets about the task of bringing God into the world. With cows as her witnesses and Joseph as her midwife, she does just that. And within moments, the hand of the star hanger clutches Mary's finger, and the feet of the sky walker lay in Joseph's palm. On this starlit night, in the company of sheep, cattle, and a bewildered husband, Mary's eyes fall on the face of her just-born son. She is surely bone-weary, likely in pain, ready to place her head on the straw and sleep the night away. But first, Mary has to see this face, his face, to wipe the moisture from his mouth and feel the shape of his chin, to be the first to whisper. So this is what God looks like. People have always wondered about the image of God. Societies have speculated and tribes have cogitated, and we've reached a variety of conclusions. God has been depicted as a golden calf and a violent wind and an angry volcano. He wears wings and breathes fire and eats infants and demands penance. We've fancied God as ferocious, magical, fickle, and maniacal, a God to be avoided or dreaded and appeased. But never in mankind's wildest imaginings did we consider that God would enter the world as an infant. John tells us that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The Word became not a whirlwind or a devouring fire, but a single cell, a fertilized egg, an embryo, a baby. And Jesus entered our world not like a human, but as a human. He endured puberty and pimples and hot weather and cranky neighbors. God became human down to his very toes. But why such a journey? Why did God go so far? Well, a chief reason is this. He wants us to know that he gets us. He understands how we feel because he has faced what we face. Jesus is not out of touch with our reality. He's been through the weakness and testing and experienced it all, everything but the sin. And because he understands, we can boldly go to him. And because of Bethlehem's miracle, we can answer some fundamental questions. Does God care when we're sad? Just look at the tear-streaked face of Jesus as he stands near Lazarus's tomb. Does God notice when we're afraid? Note the resolve in Jesus' eyes as he marches through the stormy seas to rescue his friends. Does God know if we're ignored? Does he know if we're rejected? We'll find the answer in the compassionate eyes of Christ as he stands to defend the adulterous woman. I like to think that moment Mary gazed into the face of God, she realized it was all worth it. The ache in her back, the ache in her heart, all faded away. And the questions of how, the wonderings of when, didn't linger. The inn had no place for her son. That was all right, because he would find a place in people's hearts. She and Joseph were far from home on the night of Jesus' birth. Well, that was all right, because Jesus was even farther from his. Any doubt of the Father's love for us disappeared the night God was wrapped in barnyard towels so the hay wouldn't scratch his back. Through a scandalous pregnancy, an imposed census, an untimely trip, and an overcrowded inn, God triumphed in Mary's story. In spite of the chaos, God came into the world through a baby and revealed himself to the world. And in that moment, everything changed. Back in 1926, George Harley founded a medical mission among the Mono tribe of Liberia. The locals were receptive to the doctor and helped him construct a clinic and a chapel. Eventually, Dr. Harley treated more than 10,000 people a year in that clinic. But during the first 5 years, not one person from the tribe visited his chapel. Shortly after the doctor arrived, his wife gave birth to Bobby, their first child. And the boy grew up on the edge of the forest and was the apple of his parents' eye. But one day, when Bobby was almost 5 years old, his father looked out the window and saw Bobby fall down as he was running across the field. His son got up, ran some more, but fell down again. But this time he didn't get up. Dr. Harley ran outside and picked up the feverish body of his boy. And he quickly realized that his son was suffering from a deadly tropical fever. He tried every treatment he knew, but nothing helped. The fever raged, and in short order, the disease took the boy's life. The doctor and his wife were distraught with grief. The missionary went into his workshop and built a coffin. He placed Bobby inside and nailed the lid. Then he lifted the coffin on his shoulder and walked toward the clearing to find a place to dig a grave. Just then, one of the old men in the village saw him and asked about the box. When Dr. Harley explained that his son had died, the old man offered to help him carry the coffin. So the villager took one end of the coffin and the doctor took the other. The two men dug a grave in the forest, and there they laid the boy's coffin in it. When the grave had been covered, the doctor fell down on his knees in the dirt, and he began to sob uncontrollably. His beloved son was dead. He was in the middle of an African jungle, some 8,000 miles away from home. He felt all alone. An interesting thing occurred when Dr. Harley started crying. The old villager cocked his head in stunned amazement, squatted beside the doctor and looked at him intently. For a long time, he just sat there listening to Dr. Harley cry. Then suddenly, he leaped to his feet and ran back.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.